Welcome to a series of 7 lectures on the general theme of signification in Buddhist and French traditions. These lectures were first delivered at the Collège de France. When I was invited by Professor Claude Hajesh to deliver a series of lectures at one of the most prestigious institutes of higher learning in Europe, the Collège de France, in 1998, I proposed a typological comparison between the two most significant traditions in the history of ideas, the Buddhist and the French. The controversy between the Paninian and Bhartrihari's interpretation of language as a natural phenomenon, as opposed to the Buddhist approach to language as a social and human institution, led to two distinct traditions in India. Bhartrihari stated in no uncertain terms that the correspondence between the words and what is designated by them is natural and fixed, and no human intervention can change this relationship. For the Buddhist logicians, this relation was dialectical and dichotomizing, based on the specific conceptualizations due to human imposition. The Buddhist logicians Dignaga and Dharmakirti were the foremost thinkers in this tradition of conceptualism. Much later, from the 12th century onwards, with Pierre Abelard, the French meditations on this very crucial issue of signification were also called conceptualism by various scholars. Abelard asserted that the significance of words was derived from human imposition due to perception and human will. Positio hominum voluntas hominum. This comparison is typological and not historical. There is a marked similarity between the two theoretical reflections, but certainly no identity is either proposed or considered in my analysis. It is important to know that the famous Buddhist scholar Sharbatsky, the Russian Sharbatsky, in his Buddhist logic noted, the Indian medieval logic is filled up with a struggle between realism and nominalism, just as the Middle Ages in Europe. There is an unmistakable parallelism between the European struggle and the Indian controversy. Its general lines are similar, but not the details. It can be mentioned that Abelard, in his attempt at mediation between extreme nominalism and extreme realism, expressed views which are partially found in India. He held that the universal is more than a name, it is a predicate, sarmo, even a natural predicate. We have seen that the universal as a general concept is always the predicate of a perceptual judgment, hence all universals are nothing but predicates. See, the controversy in India and in Europe around these two main philosophical traditions, realism and nominalism, have a number of similar features. For the realists, whether they were Indian thinkers like the schools of Nyaya, Visheshika, Sankhya, Mimamsa, they all thought all reality, concrete or abstract, the things and their universal characteristics could be apprehended by the senses. Not only a particular, but also the universal, that is not only a thing, but its characteristics. For example, human, man, humanity, rationality, mortality, these features were also perceived at the level of senses. Whereas, for the Buddhists, and the same thing for the European tradition beginning with the French tradition beginning with Abelard, they considered that the first contact with reality is sensuous, with our senses, and after that it is all intellectual and imagination, it is conceptual. So, it is shown that each philosopher in both traditions is dialectically engaged with his own tradition, comes to terms with the prevalent ideologies of his times, and then proposes his own theory. What is important, however, is the fact that as the general dialectical engagement was similar, as the basic concern in both cases was the dominance of a certain realism, the philosophers of these two traditions were able to steer clear of the extreme positions adopted by the realists and the nominalist thinkers. The Buddhist thinkers interacted with the prevalent schools of the realists, the Nyaya, the Vaisheshika, the Sankhya and the Mimamsa. These schools of thought had their internal differences, but they had a common denominator in the realist philosophy, which considered that all reality, concrete or abstract, the things and their universal characteristics could be apprehended by the senses. The Buddhist philosopher Dignaga in the 6th century argued that all reality is eternally in flux. We can apprehend only the point instants. It is followed by the constitution of images of these point instants, which resemble them without being ever identical with them. And it is on these images that our intellect works and constitutes conceptual constructs. The things, the point instants, play the role of stimulants. They lead to what is called the productive imagination. It is a creative process based on imagination and intellect. The conceptual constructs are the words or utterances of our language, which we human beings construct. The whole idea here is that first we come in contact with reality, with according to the Buddhist, it is always in flux, it is always moving. There is no such thing as present. By the time we have a contact, it is already past. But this contact functions as a stimulant. You see, we have to have first contact, sensuous contact with reality. But as this reality is in flux, is eternally in flux, it stimulates our intellect, and in our domain of imaginaire, we apply our intellect, we interact with it, with our intellect and with your imagination. There is a dialectical process. We each, whatever we have before us, we analyze it dialectically and dichotomizing. This theory of Buddhist theory is generally called apoha. Apoha, unfortunately, has been considered by many scholars as a theory of negation. It is not a theory of negation, or it is or positive. It is not, there is nothing negative or positive about this theory. This theory simply emphasizes the fact that nothing is understood by itself. You have something, it must be understood in terms of the other. There is a being and the other. There is a subject and the object. The being and the other derive their being and other from each other. See, this is the basic philosophy, that it is dialectical. You see, it is not fixed. It is, you see, for the realist, for the school of Mimamsa and Sankhya and Nyaya-Vaisheshika, there is a reality, whether it is abstract or it is concrete. Both abstract and concrete reality can be apprehended by senses. Whereas the Buddhist position is that reality can be only perceived. There is the first contact, there is a pratiksha, and then there is anuman. There is a question of, first is a perception, there is inference. So inference is logical. A reality must be understood in its dialectical dynamicity and its dichotomizing universe, that every item, every thing in this universe must be understood in terms of the other, and this relationship is both dialectical and dynamic. There is no such thing as a as a static reality. For the Buddhists, the cognitive element of our mind is limited to the movement when we become aware of the presence of the object. This is the first stage. It is followed by the synthetical operation of the intellect, which constructs the image of the object. The senses apprehend, the intellect constructs, says Dharmakirti. This is very important, I repeat. The senses apprehend, the intellect constructs. Sensation leads us to apprehension of reality, particularity, vividness, and efficient affirmation. Conception, or the constructed image, on the other hand, leads us to the cognition of generality, logic, necessity, and distinctness. The object conceived is an object imagined. To conceive means to imagine, to construct an object in imagination. So, this is practically diametrically opposed to the realist position in the Indian tradition. Now, as this lecture is only introductory, we touch a few points in each tradition, and then we go to the other tradition. The second, from this we go to the European tradition. The European tradition, we take Abelard, the first philosopher, the French philosopher of the 12th century. In his book Tractatus de Intellectibus, he presents the constitution of signification in terms of sensus, imaginatio, intellectus. These are words from Latin. What it means is, the sensorial perception of corporeal reality requires a corporeal instrument. The point of departure of all understanding is our sensuous experience, exactly like the Buddhist position. This is followed by imagination and intellection. Imagination is nothing but a certain souvenir of the sensuous contact with reality, but the image of a thing or an experience is the domain of imaginaire. It is always vague, for as in sensation, the imagination also, reason does not play any role. That in this domain of perception and imaginaire, reason does not play a very important role. Then what happens? Intellection does not need any corporeal instrument. It operates on the images of things existing or non-existing, corporeal or non-corporeal. Its function is to comprehend and discern the nature of things. It is very important that Abelard is supposed to have introduced in the European tradition of philosophy the concept of pure forms, and several scholars have pointed out that before Abelard, before the 12th century, this concept does not figure anywhere, even in the Greek tradition. Abelard continues, imagination and sensation are interrelated and in a way operate in the same manner. Sensation operates on the things present, imagination on the things absent. Now, this is very important, because if one deals with the realist philosophy, the thing is always present. There is a question of presence, and then you analyze, and the even the what you abstract is also considered to be a sensuous process, sensuous analysis. Whereas, in conceptualism, because the term conceptualism is used both for the Buddhist enterprise and the French enterprise. The concept is an abstract idea. It is as the reality is perceived and analyzed, not as the reality is. So, there is a difference between conceived reality and sensuously experienced reality. Sensation operates on the things present, imagination on the things absent. However, as both are devoid of the faculty of reason, the forms of things they correspond to are always vague and confused. There is no perceptive judgment at the level of sensuous experience. As there are three modes in the domain of perception, the mode of being, modus essendi, the mode of intellection, modus intellecti, and the mode signification, modus significandi. It all depends upon how the conceptual constructs are constituted. There can be different intellections for each different word or each different nature or characteristics of a thing, or one unique intellection of different things. It is very much like Bhartrihari, Hari's fort. Abelard talks about one single impulse of articulation and comprehension. Abelard continues, intellection operates other than the sensuous experience. When instead of one single impulsion, it follows the procedure of division, disjunction and abstraction. The intellection that divides is the intellection of negation, but the one who operates a disjunction creates an intellection of affirmation. If he does not create distinctions between one thing and the other and of several things that it conceives in the spirit. When we obtain an intellection by abstraction, we conceive a thing other than the way it really exists. See, the point is that in conceptualism, in both French and Buddhist conceptualism, what we conceive is abstract, and that is not a physical reality. The a given person, you see, as they used to say in the European tradition, we know Socrates, we can talk to him and we can discuss with him, he knows how we know how he looks like. But what is man? Socrates is a man, is one thing, but what is man in general? There are so many men, they are all different from each other. So, when we talk about man, about the mortality of man, not mortality of Socrates, then or rationality, then we are in the domain of conceptualization, and conceptualization is abstract. It is not concrete. It can only be perceived and it depends upon how how we constitute our conceptual constructs, and not how, you see, it is not as reality is, but as reality is perceived, as reality is analyzed dialectically and dichotomizingly. In the French tradition, we have the second major figure in the French tradition that continues the Abelardian theory of signification is the 18th century philosopher Condillac, whose approach is denominated linguistic conceptualism by the historian of linguistic thought Sylvain Auroux. Ideas of Condillac, which we will deal in detail in subsequent lectures. He says, Condillac, our reflection has two objects, argues Condillac in L'art de penser, the book was written in 1796, the actual sensation and the sensation that we have had earlier, these two interact to crystallize each other. That means something that we had a sensation, an object, and a series of our contacts with the objects. As the sensible objects are complex, we can compare only by means of abstractions. That what we are comparing are abstract. We compare rationality of or something, animality, socialization, social, man is a social animal, man is a thinking being. So, this faculty of thinking is abstract, it is not something concrete. So, this can be understood only by in terms of comparisons and logical dialectical interactions. This operation of abstractions enables us to see what is common to them and what distinguishes one from the other. This is also very important. It is not just what is common, but this is also what is distinct from the other. See, if we want to understand one thing, we understand it in terms of the other, which has some similarities and some dissimilarities. We do not just compare anything with anything. There are things which can be compared. What can be compared? Two objects can be compared when there is something common, and also because there is something distinct. So, and this is the fundamental process of comparison. This operation of abstraction enables us to see what is common to them and what distinguishes one from the other. We then distribute them in different classes. Our senses cannot apprehend abstract ideas or ideas in general. We can see a given man or a given tree, but we can never see a man in general, a tree in general. What is underscored here is that when we utter a word, when we there is a word of a language and there is an object, there is a designation between the two. There are two definitions. What one definition is what is called tertiary definition, and that is Abelardian definition, and that is that the word leads to the idea, idea to the thing. Lamo men a lide, lide a la chose. That is that when we utter the word of our language refers not to the object, but to the idea of the object, and from the idea of the object we go to the object. There used to be in the 17th century France another definition, a little more complex, which is quaternary definition. That is, on the one side you have the word and the other side you have the object. See? But the process of signification, the process of constituting the conceptual constructs are from the word you go to the idea of the word, because the word itself has a certain resonance, a certain form. So, not only what it says, the content, but the form of the word is also very important for signification. This is why from the utterance of the word leads to the idea of the word, and from that idea of the word you go to the object of the word, and this is how the last stop in our typological journey is Maurice Merleau-Ponty. Beginning with the Saussurean long paroled plurality, which for all practical purposes for Saussure meant the social and the individual aspect of language, Merleau-Ponty attempts to present our communication system as a dialectic between parole parle and parole parlant. Instead of Saussurean etadalang, which are more or less homogeneous, Merleau-Ponty, like his predecessors Abelard and Condillac in the French tradition and Dignaga and Dharmakirti in the Buddhist tradition, introduces the concept of dynamicity of the communication process. It is an affair of the physical acquisition of language and the conceptual appropriation of the signifying ensembles. It is a domain of the imaginaire, of the conceptual constructs, where with the instruments of communication at our disposal, the parole parle, the given, the language which is already there, the cultural norm, we are engaged in a continuous dialectical interaction to go beyond the given, to say what has never been said before, to constitute conceptual constructs for the other with the help of language in praxis, the parole parlant.
So, ultimately we will have two major figures on the Buddhist side, Dignaga and Dharmakirti, and three on the French side, Abelard in the 12th century, Condillac in the 18th, and Merleau-Ponty in the 20th. In the subsequent lectures, we will concentrate, we will more take one great thinker at a time and discuss in detail his theory and all the implications. Thank you.